During the age of Greek gods, the goddess Circe is born as the daughter of the sun god Helios and the Okeanid nymph Perse. Helios also fathers her two siblings, her brother Aeetes, who becomes king of Colchis and keeper of the Golden Fleece, and her sister Pasiphae, who becomes the wife of King Minos and mother of the Minotaur. These siblings are all demigods who live legendary lives in their own right, but Circe in particular stands out for her reputation as a witch and a temptress. She presides over the moon in love, but finds herself worshipping Hecate, the goddess of witchcraft and necromancy. As such, she grows up to be an exceptionally talented mage who specializes in herbalism, creating many potions and drugs with magical effects. Despite her siblings also sharing this reverence for Hecate, Circe is not too fond of them. She views Aeetes as a lazy, blockheaded king, and is jealous of Pasiphae's divine beauty. In contrast, Circe's petite form is often mistaken for that of a child, which angers her to no end. Wishing to live apart from her siblings, Circe takes up residence at the island of Aea, where she enjoys a seemingly innocent and pampered lifestyle. One must never be fooled by her alluring charm, however, as she becomes known as the Falcon Witch for a reason. Circe has a fondness for human men, and according to her whims, she will turn them to animals out of envy or boredom. Yes, the men who visit her island do not return, instead being turned into lions, wolves, and pigs, forced to live out the rest of their days as her pets and livestock. It is ironic then that Circe has a disdain for cats, claiming they take advantage of others with their adorable nature. When she sets her sights on a particular man as an outlet for her affections, she demonstrates no tolerance for rejection or compromise. One such victim is Picus, the first king of Latium. He encounters Circe while on a hunting trip, and proceeds to endure as she tries to seduce him with her charms and herbs. Already happily married, Picus refuses the goddess, incurring her jealous wrath. As punishment for scorning her love, Circe turns him into a woodpecker, unsurprisingly tarnishing his future. Even the gods are no match for her toxic infatuation. More famously, she falls in love with the sea god Glaucus, but their courtship is tarnished by Glaucus's infidelity. He has the nerve to ask her for advice in pursuit of a different woman, the nymph Scylla. Discovering this affair, Circe takes her anger out, not on Glaucus, but upon the beloved maiden. She poisons the water in which Scylla bathes, turning the nymph into a nightmarish, multi-headed monster. It is said that Circe cutting her own hair short is the result of her being overwhelmed by unrequited love. To solidify Circe's eternal infamy as a seductive witch, she serves to obstruct the hero Odysseus on his journey home from the Trojan War. Unaware of Circe's scheming, Odysseus lands on her island and is shocked to see it inhabited by docile lions and wolves. Lured by Circe's delightful singing, he and his crew find her home and are suspiciously welcomed in. Naive to her generosity, the men feast upon the wheat porridge she offers them. This porridge is, of course, poisonous, turning most of the crew into swine. Taking a liking to Odysseus, Circe bewitches him with glorious feast and passionate lovemaking for an entire year, until Odysseus utilizes the divine protection of Hermes to break her spell. Impressed by his gift and determination to reach his homeland, Circe sends him on his way, but not until after advising him of the horrors that await beyond her island. She tasks him with venturing into the underworld and warns him about the monstrous Scylla. Despite this warning, Odysseus is ultimately forced to pass by the creature, suffering as six of his crewmates are devoured, one for each of Scylla's heads. Later stories tell of how Circe births Odysseus' three sons, who go on to rule kingdoms of their own. Certainly men continue to fear Circe and her island, but there is one woman who forgoes the tales out of admiration for her talent for magecraft. Circe's niece, Medea, travels to her island from Colchis, sailing across the Black Sea and through the archipelago. Medea's crew fears the island, citing how men who go there never return, and yet she proceeds with optimism. The sailors abandon her on the island and flee, leaving her to fend for herself. Circe finds Medea by the shoreline, having never met her own niece before. She doesn't hold Aeetes in the highest regard, referring to him as the least accomplished of her siblings. But in contrast, Medea shows great potential as both a woman and a mage. Cersei wishes the best for her, advising her not to squander her talents as a trophy wife for some man. Thus, despite her refusal to take on an apprentice, Cersei reluctantly takes Medea in and trains her to be a priestess of Hecate. Tragically, even with her aunt's guidance, Medea suffers the very same fate she was warned to avoid. Such is the cruelty of the gods. At the height of her influence on the world, Cersei manages to play the role of a wild card, being both an inspiration and detriment to the fates of various heroes. She has those she desires and cherishes, but remains apathetic to many. Regardless, she is influential enough to be recorded into the Throne of Heroes, likely as someone who walks the line between hero and anti-hero. Thankfully, this provides her the chance to prove her benevolence to an extent. In the modern era, the Chaldea Security Organization fights to protect the human order by resolving singularities. After the defeat of Getia, a handful of demon gods manage to escape and burrow themselves into moments in history. Such is the case with the demon god Raum, who takes the region of Salem, Massachusetts hostage and reenacts the witch trials as a means of summoning an otherworldly threat. Chaldea normally dispatches their master, Ritsuka Fujimaru, to these anomalies in order to combat the demon gods with servants summoned through the facility's fate system. That said, not all servant summons are so straightforward. While experimenting with the system, Chaldea's acting director, Leonardo da Vinci, accidentally summons Cersei. It seems as though Cersei's presence is the result of a malfunction from Chaldea's observatory lens. Rather than making her presence known, Cersei attempts to flee the facility, only to discover that Chaldea is an isolated construct in the Arctic. Unable to fully trust Chaldea, she takes caution, observing their actions directly. In order to blend in, Cersei transforms herself to take the appearance of her niece Medea and steals her opportunity to join the Rayshift to Salem in disguise. Whilst playing Medea's role in the party, she buys herself time by jamming Ritsuka's communications with Chaldea. Given time to observe the party, Cersei witnesses as Ritsuka and their servants face tension and ridicule from Salem's Puritan residents. Believing herself to have been guided thus far, she decides to reveal her true identity and formally join Chaldea's ranks. In such a dire situation, Ritsuka is more than happy to welcome another ally. And sure enough, Cersei is a very useful servant. For one thing, she can take flight, appropriate for someone labeled the Falcon Witch in life. She wears a pair of fake falcon wings that function when grafted directly to her magic circuits. In battle, these wings can generate and launch feather projectiles at her foes. Known for her magecraft, Cersei can conjure surges of lightning, twisters, and even her own form of Medea's Machia Hecatia Graea, Reign of Light, to vanquish threats via a devastating laser cannon. Manifesting from her legends, Cersei proves capable of weaponizing the monstrous Scylla. By pouring the mud of a grail-like object, she creates a portal through which Scylla can emerge and ravage victims. That said, none of these are her preference. Rather, her favorite magecraft involves transforming victims into helpless animals. This is the basis behind her noble phantasm, Metabo Piglet's Forbidden Revelry. It is a reality marvel where all the men she seduced into swine in life return to cause havoc. These pigs rampage among her banquet hall, succumbing to the ecstasy of Cersei and her extravagant feasts. Despite her destructive might, Cersei best serves Chaldea through her wits and protection. Ritsuka's servants, one by one, begin to find themselves accused of witchcraft, leading to their exotic dancer, Mata Hari, standing trial as a seductress and a harlot. As tragic as this is, Ritsuka's hands are tied in that Chaldea must play into the demon god's schemes, uncertain of the singularity's true nature. They go along with her sentence and watch as Mata Hari is brought to be hanged. Of course, Cersei has no intention of letting her meet such a grim fate, and devises a secret plan to ensure her survival. Cersei creates a poison that, when taken prior to the noose, prevents the blood from leaving Mata Hari's head. This, in combination with Mata Hari's ability to cushion her neck, allows the beloved dancer to fake her own death, fooling the ignorant villagers, and for a time, even Ritsuka. Cersei remains a valuable asset to the team, helping uncover Rome's disguise as Randolph Carter. He completes his ritual to summon an outer god into the body of Abigail Williams, but quickly finds himself unable to contain such power. Even Caldea cannot hold back the surges of power emanating from Abigail, which threaten to harm the planet beyond the Singularity. To give Rizka the chance to defeat Abigail, Cersei teams up with Sheba to place a barrier in the town hall to contain them. This proves effective, as the other servants manage to purge Abigail of her outer god. In the aftermath, Cersei acknowledges that she, along with Sheba, will disappear, as is the case for other singularities. That said, there is nothing to prevent Rizka from simply summoning the demigoddess intentionally this time. As a result, Cersei's wild past of toying with the lives of men is now focused in an effort to preserve humanity, proving that witchcraft is not inherently evil, not even for the self-proclaimed Queen Witch. Thanks for watching. If you enjoy this channel, help me beat the algorithm by liking, commenting, and sharing the video, subscribing to Otaku Daikun, and most of all, smashing that notification bell as if it were your waifu. That way, you'll never miss out on all of my anime content, lore videos, live streams, and Holy Waifu Wars polls. My vids are struggling to get featured, so that bell is absolutely critical. If you want to support me directly, check out my Patreon, or consider donating via Super Chat. And as always, celebrate your fandom.